Labor's landslide victory on Saturday was extraordinary in its endorsement for the Jacinda Ardern-led party, 64 seats. The first time since we adopted MMP in 96 that a party's won enough seats to comfortably govern alone. But should it? Or would it be wiser to form some form of accommodation with the Greens? And what about Rawiri Waititi, who special votes allowing looks set to bring the Māori Party back into Parliament? For Labor, does coalition mean dilution or expansion? And for the Greens and the Māori Party, does coalition mean having a voice or being swamped by a larger voice? Here to discuss the pros and cons, risks and rewards. We are really grateful to welcome to breakfast two lovely guests. AUT lecturer and political commentator, Dr. Ella Henry. Kia ora. Kia ora. And Ben Thomas, political commentator, PR consultant and former press secretary to National Minister Christopher Finlayson. Mōrena kōrua. Nice to have you both here. Mōrena. Ella, I just want to pick up before we move on as an AUT lecturer about what Iona Halstead was saying. Are you seeing students under immense economic pressure because of job losses or economic deprivation at home?
Absolutely, and across the board, and not just job pressures, you know, housing insecurity, access to data, access to hardware. We've had enormous pressures in the classroom, and if this government is going to roll out more access to education, then they're going to make sure they're going to need to make sure that the students have access to the hardware and software that will form learning for the foreseeable future.
We, you know, children were Zooming from home, but to Zoom from home for lots of hours a day under lockdown, you need all you
data.
Can need broadband, right? And a lot of people, yeah, okay. Let's pull out from the micro to the macro, which is how this government responds to these times. Ben, can I switch to you? What do you think Jacinda Ardern should do in terms of the Greens and a Māori Party MP?
Labor's chief political driver will be trying to co-opt these parties, essentially to reduce a tax on it from its left flank, in the Greens' case, or on Māori issues, where it is looking vulnerable. You know, they were run close in many of those Māori seats.
Yeah, they were close in three seats, right?
Yeah, that's right, and actually lost. The only seat they lost was that Māori electorate in Wairiki. And so, you know, look, Labor's got an incentive to do that. The other reason, I think, to bring the Greens into the fold is actually I don't think that Labor can afford to lose James Shaw, Julianne Genta, Eugenie Sage, Jan Logie, who have all done great work this term. Also in the talent pool, somebody like Chloe Swarbrick, who the whole country now knows, you know, just what she's capable of. What we saw in the last Labor government was there was a bit of a talent deficit there. They were really stretching to make up the numbers in cabinet. Their senior competent ministers are under a huge workload right now. Look at Chris Hipkins, education and health. David Parker has about half of the portfolios of government. And I think that they could really do with bringing in that talent from the Greens.
Dr. Ella Henry?
I agree entirely. Who thought? Who would have thought? But what I think is also really interesting, I was taken by what Dame Salmond yesterday about how Jacinda Ardern has used aroha almost as a methodology, because it is a practical approach to working together. It's not just love, it's empathy and respect. And if she can incorporate that in a meaningful way in how she brings her friends around her, you know, as Helen Clark said, we all need friends in politics for the bad times. I think that's going to be important, and it would speak volumes to Māori if she were to find a place for Rawiri. Those Māori who gave their candidate vote to the Māori Party but still kept their party vote with Labour. So speaking volumes to them, I think, is about, you know, shoring up her relationship with Māori into the future, making use of the talent. But here's another thing is, what let down both parties during the last term was the numbers of MPs that slipped up, especially ministers. So they're going to need a lot more training, orientation and preparation. What a perfect time to create little groups of aroha around ministers.
Absolutely. You see a role for Marama Davidson in that respect, don't
Absolutely.
You? The Greens Party co-leader. So because it seems she has an enormous energy in areas in which the government has arguably been deficient. What would you do with her if you were Jacinda Ardern?
Certainly looking at child poverty around issues of oranga tamariki. But you know, let's stop thinking about power as a hierarchy with one person at the top of it. In the ancient Māori world, it was collective power. So let's see how they can convert those ministerial roles into collective power units.
Sorry to ask a Wellington question, but in terms of the machinations of government, Ben Thomas, how do you make that work? So how do you create a cabinet in which power is shared in the terms that Dr. Henry was describing?
Well, I don't think that there's any chance the Greens will have ministers in cabinet.
So they'll have ministers outside cabinet, as they did last time.
Yeah, they will have influence in portfolios. And I think from Labor's point of view, it makes sense to essentially farm out a portfolio like Oranga Tamariki, which is, you know, certainly a graveyard for any Labor minister that takes it. Marama Davidson, you would give it to her. She's got a skill set suited to that. You say, give it your best shot. The Greens would count that as a win. And it manages to keep Labor completely isolated from a really no-win portfolio.
It would also mean that Kamal Sepuloni and Marama Davidson might spend more time working together, which I would see as a potentially formidable combination, Ella Henry.
Absolutely. And the whole notion, you know, yes, I agree with you in principle, Ben, but the reality is those ministers are going to be facing incredible workloads. And if somehow there was the capacity to create the kind of inside-outside cabinet relationships, because ultimately politics is as much about influence as it is about power.
It's also about survival. And I'm thinking of Rawiri Waititi and Waiariki, who was, you know, the comeback story. And this is Te Ororoa's level seat and, you know, go the Māori Party winning there. But we know what happened to the Māori Party when they went into government with National. Can the Māori Party make this win for them?
I'd like to think so, because I've always been a strong supporter of an authentic Indigenous political voice in this country that is not hamstrung by the left-right dichotomy, you know, that can actually represent Māori interests vocally and publicly. And I think that this is a wonderful time for Labor and Jacinda to reach out and to figure out ways of incorporating that voice.
So I would disagree with that. I think that Rawiri, especially if they don't gain another seat on the specials. It might be a different matter if Debbie Nadi Wapaka makes it in on the list. But otherwise, Rawiri Waititi is going to have a very hard time in Parliament as a lone MP. It is a lonely place.
It's a tough place.
And representing the aspirations of a whole party, I don't think he would want to be sort of subsumed into Labour like that. He really needs... The Māori Party, remember, ran on quite a radical platform this year, you know, very different to its previous sort of more moderate kind of policy programmes. And I don't think that they would want to water that down.
And
coming,
you know,
into the next
that
election.
Is Māori politics in terms of mainstream views. Everything, our aspirations for self-determination and for, you know, approaching poverty issues, that is a radical approach to many. And what you've got to remember is, you know, Rawiri is whānau apanui. They're never alone. They run in packs.
Yeah. That's a very good point. Okay, final question to each of you. What is the most important signal that Jacinda Ardern needs to send in terms of how she deals with her allies?
The capacity to work collaboratively, which she spoke about on Saturday night. What is that going to look like, and how is that going to work for her and for the Parliament?
Ben?
The only thing she needs to do is think about what's best for her her party. I think that there will be a temptation to offer the Greens, you know, these kind of tokenistic deals that they've accepted in the past, you know, 400 houses insulated, you know, sustainable light bulbs in government department head offices, and they will need to come up with something a little better than that for the Green Party, which, remember, actually increased its share of the vote in this election.
Yeah. I said final question before, but we haven't talked about the Labour newbies. Can you give us a name each? I don't know if either of you have thought about this, because is there anyone we should be looking out for who may be a bolter?
Well, I don't know if you'd call Dr. Aisha Viral a bolter. She's a star recruit.
They've got to use her for sure, aren't
Barbara
they?
Edmund.
It's a broad church of talent. I look forward to seeing how they're all going to work together, because actually, from this week on, they've got to start looking at real issues.
Yeah, real issues like we were discussing just before 7. Ben Thomas, pundit, much in demand. Just keep it up. I know you said on Twitter this is your last one. We look forward to seeing you somewhere else tomorrow, Ben. And Dr. Ella Henry doing fantastic work at AUT. Thank you both for joining us.